So the question is not whether we Christians are salt or not. The question is, are we functioning as our role as salt for this earth? Okay, Pastor Steve, you might be thinking, well, what does that mean? What is our function as salt? You know, Joan gave us a lot of clues in her children's moment this morning. You know, but I really think it boils down to our function as being that we are called as Christians to try to hinder the decay of the world and to emphasize the world's best qualities.
Good morning. Please rise either in body or in spirit and join me in our call to worship. Gather now, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
We come to celebrate God's kingdom.
Here you will experience God's grace and love.
We come to embrace God's spirit and truth.
Prepare your hearts and minds for worship.
We come to humbly bow down. Let our worship begin.
Please remain standing and join your voices in our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, found on page 90 in your hymnal. We will sing the first and the fourth verses. Please join me now in the unison prayer of illumination found in your bulletins. Shall we pray? Guide us, O God, by your word, that in your light we may see light, in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover peace.
Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning was taken from the fifth chapter of Matthew, verses 13 through 16. Listen now to this word from the Holy Scripture. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trodden underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid, nor do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a stand, and it gives light to all the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to the Father who is in heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll ask the children to come forward for the time of children and youth as we sing Jesus' name.
Dear God,
Thank you for making us the salt of the world. Help us to stay salty and spread your love. Amen.
Thank you, gentlemen, for that salty message. About one of our salts here. This is not the one that I saw Elliot stick his fingers in his mouth the next day. I don't know, sea salt that you have there. But anyway, salt has been in this kind of container for a long time, as long as I can remember. And I have a memory that I want to share with you, and I was trying to remember, is this what the salt looked like that my grandfather had? I don't remember if it was or not, because it was 50 years ago, I was thinking of over 50 years ago, unfortunately. So, the title of my message this morning is Not Enough Salt, and it actually has nothing to do with the roads or the sidewalks. I wasn't planning for us to have a big snowfall on this Sunday. But it begins with a memory that I have of my grandparents' house. When I was in second, third, and fourth grade, I lived in Winona, Missouri, which is where all of my grandparents and many of my relatives lived at that time. And I would always go, after school, we'd go to my grandparents' house, my brother and sister and I. And I have a memory of that time, a very strong memory etched in my mind, of sitting at the table in the kitchen with my grandmother, and she's sitting there doing something with food, either snapping green beans or peeling potatoes or doing something with food. She seemed like she was always doing that. And on her stove, there was always a big pot of beans cooking on her stove, brown beans actually, that we had all the time. And there was always some cornbread there on the side as well. Because Grandma said she never knew when somebody was going to show up, and they might be hungry, and she wanted to have some beans and cornbread for them. And so that was always cooking on the stove. But my memory is sitting there at the table. My brother and sister were there. My grandmother was there doing something with food. We were sitting around either helping her or watching her. And my grandpa would come in. And when Grandpa would walk into the kitchen, the first thing he would always do is walk over to that pot of beans, take the lid off the top, take a taste of it and say, not enough salt. Take the salt and sprinkle a little more salt in there and put the lid back on. I don't think it mattered to him what it actually tasted like. He decided it needed more salt, even before he tasted it. Because my grandfather was really a believer in, you couldn't get too much of a good thing. And he thought salt on your food was a really good thing. So he wanted to make sure that any of the food had plenty of salt. So I can remember him time and time again coming in, tasting the bean, and saying, not enough salt. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So our scripture this morning talks about salt. A Peanuts cartoon with Peppermint Patty talking to Charlie Brown. And she says to Charlie Brown, guess what, Chuck? Today, as you know, was the first day back at school after Christmas break. And I got in trouble and sent to the principal's office. And you know what, Charlie Brown? It's your fault. Charlie Brown says, what? My fault? How could it be my fault? I wasn't there. I didn't even see you today at school. Why do you say, Peppermint Patty, why do you say that everything is my fault? Peppermint Patty says, well, you're my friend, aren't you, Charlie Brown? You should have been a better influence on me. You know, in that little cartoon, Peppermint Patty sort of seems like she's trying to pass the buck. But in a very real sense, she's saying something that's correct here. We are supposed to be a good influence on the people that we are in contact with, especially our friends. We certainly do have an influence on other people, for good or for bad. And we are what we are, and we do influence all the others that are around us on a daily basis. So what is it that we are? Well, Jesus, in this passage from the very famous Sermon on the Mount, he said that we are the salt of the earth. So I guess there's the earth, and then there is you, the salt. And my grandpa would say that salt is a very good thing. You are the salt of the earth. I think it's important to note that when Jesus said this, he wasn't really asking for volunteers. He doesn't say, hey, does anyone want to be the salt? He says, you are the salt of the earth. Whether you want to be or not, you are the salt of the earth. You is emphatic. You are the salt of the earth. So the question is not whether we Christians are salt or not. The question is, are we functioning as our role as salt for this earth? Okay, Pastor Steve, you might be thinking, well, what does that mean? What is our function as salt? You know, Joan gave us a lot of clues in her children's moment this morning. You know, but I really think it boils down to our function as being that we are called as Christians to try to hinder the decay of the world and to emphasize the world's best qualities. To bring out the best qualities that we can see, that we know exist in this earth. Just as salt enhances the flavor of food, we should be enhancing life for all those that we come in contact with on behalf of our tongue. We are the salt of the earth. We are absolutely essential to the establishing of God's kingdom on this earth. Now, we know that literal salt, with all of our scientific knowledge these days, we know that salt is a stable compound. It is sodium chloride. It cannot, strictly speaking, lose its saltiness, or it would no longer be sodium chloride. Sodium chloride is salty precisely because that's what it is. It's sodium chloride, and it is salted. And that's sort of the irony of Jesus' point that he's making here. It's sort of an inconceivable situation. Salt can't really lose its saltiness. If we are the salt, how could we lose that saltiness? But salt can become contaminated with impurities and thus lose its salty taste. Jesus said it could become tasteless. And really, if you think about it, salt in Jesus' day was not like our refined salt that Joan brought so many different types of for us to look at and consider this morning. The white powder that they called salt back in Jesus' day was not refined in some factory. It did contain some amount of sodium chloride. You see me expressing surprise like that because my thing came loose from the belt. And I'm like, oh, it's pulling in my head. Salt did have some amount of sodium chloride in it, but it was mixed with all of other types of impurities, things that we might consider today to be just road dust. You know, there was all kinds of dust that was mixed in. They didn't have a way to really refine it and make it pure salt. And if that salt became too much road dust and not enough pure sodium chloride, it could lose its saltiness. It might become worthless. It might not have been any good for preserving food. It might not have added any extra flavor or enhanced the flavor of food if really all you were putting on there was primarily dust instead of sodium chloride. And I think that's what Jesus was referring to, that the same holds true for his followers, of Christians, of us. If we become too diluted by the dust of the world, we too also may become worthless as far as the kingdom of God is concerned. But Jesus says we are the salt. That is our identity. That's who we are. And just as salt hinders the decay of food and emphasizes its best flavors, our function as Christians should be to hinder the decay of this world and to emphasize its best qualities. So that's our challenge as Christians, to be the salt of the earth, to influence the world for Jesus. Make no mistake about it, you do influence the world. So what about your influence, my friends? What about that challenge from Peppermint Patty? And more importantly, the challenge that Jesus gives us in this passage. We have to recognize that we do influence the people that are around us. So the question is, are we really being the salt that Jesus calls us to be? So what does Jesus expect us to do as salt? Well, what are we supposed to do? What does Jesus expect of you and of me? Well, I believe our influence in the world depends on us as Christians being distinctive. Just as salt is a distinctive flavor, distinctive taste. We are salt, and therefore we must preserve our ability to enhance life for other people. And to do that, we should be distinct. You know, salt has a very distinct flavor. It's unlike any other taste in the world. Can you think of anything else that tastes like salt? It's distinct. It's unique. It is special. So too, we as Christians should be distinct. We should stand apart and be unlike anything else that someone might encounter in this world. Because our God empowers us to make a difference in the world. Empowers us to take a stand. To be distinct. We must live in this world, but we don't have to be of this world. And when Christians are different from most of the rest of the world, I think the world then is attracted to Jesus and to Christianity. And when we are indistinguishable from the rest of the world, we're going along doing just as everything everyone else does, we're really useless to the cause of Jesus Christ. And if you think of it in those terms, it's quite a challenge we have before us to be the salt of the earth. We can't mingle so much that we become diluted. We serve no one by attempting to obliterate or minimize the differences between Christians and non-Christians. You know, I think one of the great tragedies of the church today is our tendency to conform rather than be distinct from the rest of the world. We are called to develop a Christian perspective of living and of dealing with the world. We are called to follow Jesus. And by following Jesus' way, truth, and life, Jesus is asking us to be courageous. And to be outspoken in condemning evil that we see in this world. So Jesus is asking us to take a stand for what is good, for what is decent, for what is true. Jesus is asking us to confront issues that really are causing problems in the lives of people. When we see those in our own lives, in our own communities. And Jesus is, of course, asking us to be a friend to all of God's people. Not just those people that are easy to love, but be a friend to all of God's people. And Jesus is asking us to praise those things that enhance life as God intended life to be. Wow, none of those things are an easy task. They are very difficult. They are a challenge on a daily basis. But Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. You must not fail the world you are called to serve. If you ever doubted your worth, you might say, well, what? I don't really make a difference anyway, do I? Think about this. The world, your world, needs you. If you're not the salt in your world, whatever that world may be, whatever the people that you come into contact with, the people that you influence, if you're not the salt in your world, how will the decay be hindered in your little piece of the world? If you're not the salt, who is going to enhance the lives of the people that you come into contact with? You are the salt. My friends, as a Christian, be who you are. Jesus said, you're the salt of the earth. You simply don't have a choice in the matter. You can and you do make a difference in the lives of the other people that you come into contact with. So do not let my grandpa's famous words, when you taste of the beans, to be a part of your legacy. Not enough salt. As Christians, we must always remember that we alone are the salt of this earth. As we represent Jesus Christ to the rest of the world, we are the hope of this world. May God help us even this day to be different from the rest of the world, to stand out, to be distinct, and may the world benefit by our difference and come to glorify the Father, God the Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ. You are the salt of the earth. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. So let us rise in your body or spirit and sing the first and third verses of this wonderful hymn found on page 389 of your hymnal. Let us now rise together and sing the first and third verses.
Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do Lord.
to every friend and every stranger we meet, whether at work, at school, anywhere in our daily lives. Remind us to be the salt. And today, we rejoice as the barriers of race, gender, age disappear as Christians around the world gather at your table, our God. Here we are neither male nor female, we're not black, brown, yellow, red, nor white, we are one. We are one race, the human race, one body sharing this one common globe. So we gather at this table knowing that all of us fall short of your glory, our God. If we pretend to be worthy, we know that we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. And yet, sinners that we are, we still come because we truly believe your grace is for all, even for us. And that if we confess our sin, you promise to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So at this table, our God, we know our sins are wiped away. All grudges are forgotten in the healing community we rejoice to be a small part of. Around this table, yes, we are all different, but through the transforming power of the Holy Spirit, we are all one. As long as we remember who we are, whose we are, we carry that holy sense of community with us. So we come here to pray, we go out to serve in the name of the one who invites all who are weary to find rest. So hear our prayers, O God, in the name of Jesus, who taught us how to live, how to build community, and how to pray as we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On that fateful night that we refer to now as the Last Supper, Jesus gathered with his closest acquaintances, his friends, his family for the last 3 years, his disciples, as they sat around table and they shared and they fellowshiped with each other. As they prepared to eat the meal, Jesus took the bread and he broke it. He returned thanks for it. And he said, "Take, eat. This bread is my body, broken for you. Whenever you eat of this bread, this do in remembrance of me." And he shared the loaf with them around the table. And they partake of that loaf and they shared the meal together. And near the end of that meal, Jesus also took the cup. And after returning thanks for it, he told them that this cup is the new covenant between you and your God. For this cup represents my blood, which is to be spilled for the sins of all, for your sins. Whenever you drink of this cup and eat of this bread, this do in remembrance of me. And he shared the cup with them around the room. My friends, the table has been prepared. Now is when we are all invited to share in the Lord's Supper. So I would ask that you take your individual element cups and turn it over so that the juice is down, and open the top first. And take the piece of bread. And remember that Jesus said that this was his body, broken for you. In like fashion, if you will turn your cup over, peel the top back from the juice. Jesus said, this is the cup of the new covenant, for this represents my blood spilled for your sin. Whenever you drink of this, this do in remembrance of me. Shall we pray? Gracious God, we remember. We remember the great sacrifice made on our behalf, the breaking of the body and the spilling of the blood. And then we celebrate in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in recognition of the fact that these things were done for us, and because of these actions, our sins have been forgiven. We forever thank you, Almighty God. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is number 383. We are going to sing all of the verses of Breed on Me, Breath of God. Before we leave here this morning, I want to feel that breath of God on us. So let us now rise together as we sing all verses of Breed on Me, Breath of God. Warm up, and hopefully most of this snow will melt away. You can go out and be on about your life and not have to worry about skidding around on the highways or the roads. But whatever you're doing this week, always remember that God is right there with you. Because God says you're the salt of the earth. And it's up to us to make that difference in the world. Go in peace this day, my friends. Amen.